So let me ask you first, did you find the stage very easy? Because I was thinking at some point nobody will be here because it's so far away from the stage one. So welcome. I have around 30 minutes and around 55 slides, so I'm going to start really slow. So let me ask you some questions here. How many of you attended the Google I/O this year? Cool. There was a session on Google I/O about the security, which will probably not be going to be published on the website, but probably the slides will be available. It's called Security Update. Search on the internet. It's the most important update every year about the security of the platform. So let's start like this. So I'm Marius Mailat. I'm a Google developer expert since this year. I'm the CTO of my company, which is AppsRise. We do handcrafted mobile apps. I trained around 500 developers on Android in the whole world, and I'm running a Romanian community for Android. Now, what we are going to discuss today is, first, why this crazy topic? I changed this in the morning because I was asked really for a lot of people, what is the motivation to do something like this? It makes no sense. How you get in contact with this type of information? And then I'm going to show you a little bit about the Android platform, how the platform works, and then some really hands-on data, how you can extract data from your phone, or at least how the police is doing that. So why this crazy topic? Mainly because we all code Android, hopefully. Who is coding Android here? Okay, cool. The whole full house. Basically, because we do this, and we do this probably... let's ask again, who is coding Android since 2011? Cool. So almost one-third of the room, which is quite a lot, mainly. Now, when we started all on Android, there was only the phones. But I think some of us already understand at that point the vision of Android, to bring Android in a lot of devices. And this doesn't matter if the Android is Android TV or is the Android Auto and so on. Now, think about an Android Nexus player costs like $79. The time to bring your application on the Android TV is just like maybe 1 week, where you can do some user experience changes. Now, and this evolved in like digital signage and wear and so on. Now, Android is existing not only in the phones, also on wearables, and most important, in embedded devices. Now, if you think about embedded devices, then it's another level of security. And because the platform evolved in that direction, I think also our understanding of what is possible with Android is growing. I'm not sure how many of you are interested in the Android internals platform, but besides developing apps and using material design to develop cool apps, there is also another part of Android, and that's the platform itself, which you can take it, you can do your custom ROM and deploy a version of Android on a specific device, and it doesn't matter if it's a phone, a player, a set-top box, and so on. There are now two TV producers in the market which are producing Android TVs with Android inside, direct out of the fabric, and these are Sony and Philips. And why they are doing that? Because usually a cycle of development for a TV is like maybe 1 year, and they reduce it to a few months because they just develop a custom ROM, and basically the Android TV is that. Now, probably you are still not convinced. Now, let me give you just a little bit of taste of what this can mean and what to a little bit to bring in the security aspects of Android. Now, I had the pleasure to travel a lot last year, and I traveled like 4 times in China. And this is one of the, let's say, popular Chinese devices, like 80 million pre-order for this device. Only pre-orders, and the sales were about 20. It is using a custom ROM, Flyme OS, which is, in fact, Android customized with some elements and stripped down from all the Google services stuff. Now, I bought such a device from the from China, and I was playing inside of it. And at some point in the system folder where the apps are located, I saw a file which was network.txt. And I just became curious, what can be in such a file? Now, this is a custom ROM. Somebody created this. Of course, a developer. And what the guys are doing there is really easy. They just log every traffic you do on the phone. So basically, they sniff your traffic in the phone, and they log everything. And they do this on a low-level platform. Now, we're talking about a device which is sold in 20 million pieces. And you can do an app, just a simple flashlight app, whatever, which is reading this file. Because this file is available for all the apps to read. Now, at that point, I informed the Meizu, and only 3 months after that, they fixed it. But meanwhile, I went public with this, so I have no idea if somebody used it. But just to get you a little bit of idea, when you customize a ROM and you customize the platform, these are the risks. And I'm really sorry, but it's not here visible, but how many of you are using the XXX word when they write debug code? Like when you lock something and you write the tag, who is using XXX? Like every time I find like 3 people, so I'm using 2. So I can relate with this guy because he's also like, he left this unintentionally, probably, hopefully. but he did exactly something like this. Now, let's take just a hypothetical case. Let's say he did something like this. He did something wrong. So if we have a choice as police, what you are going to do? So probably we are going to snoop in his phone, snoop in his laptop, and so on. And if we are going to snoop in his phone, let's see how we can get some information. Now, this will be the boring part. So this will be no show. I'm just going to show you like 4 slides about the platform, just to introduce you some elements, and then we get in fun part. First, you already know this. Probably most of you know already this picture, more or less. Now, when we talk about the platform and the Android, we all know this is based on the Linux kernel. And Android did a lot of changes in the Linux kernel to make it like a mobile version. So basically, most of the changes are located in the IPC, in the power management. And there are some other ones, of course. But basically, I think, and this is my opinion, the IPC, the binder, is the place which makes Android working. So without the inter-process communication system, the whole platform will not work. Everything you do is basically wrapped over the IPC. So it doesn't matter if it's a handler, a message, an intent, and so on. All are based over the inter-process communication because you have the sandboxing, you have to communicate from one process to another. Now, Android is an object-oriented OS, and Binder was initially not developed by Google, as you probably know. It was developed by BOS, and was a lady, was hired by Google, and she brought the project into the Google. Now, like 2 years ago, Google rewrote completely the binder in something new, which is, again, the same binder at the end. Now, we have, for example, in Android, anonymous shared memory, where you can basically share a file descriptor to a memory. So you can, and if you can catch that that shared memory, then you can also get some information. Now, these are just some ideas. Like, I'm going to teach you nothing, more or less. But these are some of the how you can get to some information in the phone. And then maybe another point, which I try to discuss about, is the init startup. So there is almost zero information out there from Google how the platform works, how you can compile the platform, and how the whole platform starts. Now, the init, the initialization of the system is an interesting thing. So if you open your phone, like you do ADB shell, and you go in the root of your phone, you're going to have an init dot, will be the mainboard name and the RC. And there you find the whole startup of the platform. And it has a name, and it is a language, in fact. It's Android init language. There's a documentation on the internet. Search after Android init language, and then readme.txt, because it's a readme.txt file. It's an initialization system where you can start the system and all services inside. And just to give you just a small idea, so you can, when you boot the device, you just boot the kernel, and after that you have the installed in etd, and then you get the zygote, which starts all the other Java services and some other normal services. But basically, if you want to attack a phone, basically you start with this part. So this is the first thing which is starting, and then we have the init process, which starts all the other ones. So I will take them one by one. Now, if somebody hypothetically will ask me how will be the way you're going to attack a phone from outside, I will say, I will just create a service who is sniffing whatever, he's sniffing the platform, and I'm going to edit really fast in the init RC of the phone, just edit the file and say something like, star service, pet name, and then class class main. That means we'll be started with the whole other services in the same time. So that's it. Just create a simple service with sniffing data or whatever it's doing on the with the system permissions, copy it there, modify the init, then you have it. Now, in order to do this, you have to understand the platform. And this is just a start to understand the platform. I'm not going to give you more information than that because I have like 30 minutes and there is no time for that. But just to give you an idea, here is the place where you can modify. And go in our phone, take a look on init.rc file. Just in the root of the phone, you're going to see exactly the startup of the platform. Now, so basically what I told you is already here. You have the init process, which is the first one, which is started exactly after the kernel. And you can initialize the network, initialize some folders, and so on. Now, you are already bored, yes? I know. So we have to do this, because otherwise it will be hard. Now, let's get to the fun part. I got this question in Russia. One developer from Intel. Somebody from Intel here? So nobody. Okay, so Pavel is working on the kernel in Russia, in Novosibirsk, and he asked me if it's possible to create a dialer with one click. Now, technically, there is no application in the App Store which is doing that. Like, you start, you push a button, and you choose two contacts, and will call two persons in the same time. There is nothing like this. Now, all the time when you are asking Android if something is possible, you have to be careful, because if you say it's not possible, it will be hard. So my response to him was like, give me until tomorrow, I will look in the platform. Now the platform, and this is the way I've learned what the platform is doing, and this is the way I've learned all the other stuff I'm going to show. This is just an example how we learn from the platform what the platform is doing, but because there is no documentation about that. There is no source documentation about the platform. You cannot learn how the APIs are created, what are the services, how is the communication there. So now, this gets released in a form of, I look in the settings app, because in the call app, you can do this, basically. So this is the app here, in call Y. And the call command client is called there. Then I went a little bit further, and at the end, I saw at some point, okay, this is using IDEL. Who is used with the IDEL concept? So like 4 or 5 people. So basically, if you want to expose a service to a third-party application, you have to describe an interface of your service and to allow other applications to use your service. But the platform itself is doing the same thing. So you can basically access all the service, most of the service in the platform, jumping the whole API. And this is available from Android 1.5 until here, and they will probably never going to change this. So basically, you can jump the whole API framework and access services directly. And this is what I also suggested. Just use the IDEL, which will automatically generate the stub, which will connect you to a service using the binder. Now, this can get complicated, but this is how you can do also with the telephony service and also other services. I lost you here? Okay, good. So let's discuss about our Android forensics. So basically, there is a science where forensics is a science where you try to get untouched information from a device or from in our case from a device, and you have to bring this proof in a court. Now there are some rules to do that. And usually is because you want to prove something is wrong. Now, let me ask you, what is wrong in this picture? What do you think is wrong? Oh, somebody. That guy, the hair, like... Yeah, not really. The problem in the picture is, I think Lenin chose to remove one guy, the one which is here. So he didn't like it, and he removed him from all the pictures of that time. From on the newspaper. So that was time part. Not his hair, but really a person was removed. So now to understand, this is our motivation. You know, like you have to prove, not to think it's something. So you have to prove. So and there's a theory that every action leaves a trace. And at least in our Android devices, it is like this. Every action leaves a trace. And you can extract this data. Now, The motivation for doing this is extremely simple. I have the opportunity last year to work with two national security agencies and to help them get this data from the phones. And doing that, I learned from them the tools they are using. And the tools they are using are, I would say, quite expensive. I have no idea how many of you know Cellbright, X-rays, and so on. You do not know them because there is no trial available. These tools are extremely expensive, and they are used only by security, national security agencies. And they basically, it is a hardware you can connect to a phone, and it's extracting all the data from the phone, more or less, with some steps. And there are some tools. NCASE is also extremely popular, at least between this type of agencies. And there are also some German ones, like X-ray and so on. Now, these are tools. Most of them, they are computers in a bag with a lot of cables, and you bring them there, and it extracts data, and you can use them in trials. Now, the interest of these agencies were how we can get more than that, because we are getting like only a few data, of course, because it's software. So I started to develop some ways, and with them together also to understand what they wanted. So I'm trying now to show the ninja way, so not the like really the case hardware, but really how we can do it in the code. So there are some ways to access data on Android. This is first to bypassing the security lock, then to do a physical data extraction or software data extraction, and a logical data extraction in the last one. So let's see. So did anyone try this? Who is using a lock on the phone? Now, we can do this like after the talk. We can do a test here. I can show you like in 5 minutes, I can find your pattern. Mine is really easy. I can tell you it's a Z from Zorro. So it is so visible. Like now, this is just the basic. Once you get access to the phone, you can do almost everything you want. Of course, one of the most important things you can remove the gesture, so basically you can get rid of the one you use, or you can replace it with the one you created, and you know what is it. So basically you can put your Z back in somebody's phone if you want. Then is the physical data extraction, so you can like really take the phone and take out all the storage and get the information from there, and then use desktop tools to get to that information. Of course, it's a combination of hardware and software, so you have to break the phone, really. But logical data extraction, so because we want to go slowly there, and have another 10 minutes. So ATB, SQLite on the providers, and backup. So let's go slowly on this. So logical data extraction, basically one of your best friend is the DD command, where you can do a complete copy of a partition. So somebody knows how many partitions are in Samsung phones, for example. Because in a normal Android phone, you have like 6 partitions or something like that. Now, in Samsung, you have like 19 partitions. They added a new layer with their partitions, which is really crazy. So you can get all these partitions. You can copy like do a one-to-one copy. You have it locally, and you can work on them. And you can do this using the DD. Normally, this is available in all Android devices. There are some, like LG, where it's not available. If you don't have it, install the BusyBox, and then you can DD the partition, get it out, and search if you want to search, for example, as text inside of the partition. This is just an article about the it's Romanian, so do not worry. It's about a phone. A really popular phone was at some point the third most popular phone, and how to get it. But at the end was the same thing. So you get a copy of the platform, and then you extract the whole partition. So now you can also get a lot of data from the phone. Like you can do a zip of the application you have there. But this is more if you have like root. Now you can snoop also in the database in the system. So you can really search after database in the system. And you can do a copy of that. Now you can go also further, like you can query by hand because you have the SQLite command inside of the ADB. So on your phone there is a utility which you can use it to explore the data which is there. And of course, you can search after, for example, the SMSs which are coming and so on, because the whole database in Android is not encrypted. Now, let's talk about the locket. There are a lot of parameters for the locket, so don't use only the simple locket. Take a look at the radio. Take a look at other parameters which are there. It gives you a lot of information about your phone. And you can get also the kernel messages if you want, and of course, the information about the device. Content provider, you already more or less know this because you are developers. So you can get access to a lot of information. Like you can backup all the SMSs just using a content provider, which is, again, easy. Now, let's discuss about two topics which are quite interesting. One is the backup. Since Android 4.0, we have a backup functionality, which is more or less okay, but still kind of crazy because you can backup basically the applications with the information inside. So you can backup the WhatsApp with the password which are there. So, and if you didn't set up a password yet for your phone, because this is hard to find, then you can set up before you do that. So you get a confirmation like this one. I'm really sorry, it's in German. But you can extract a copy of your WhatsApp application with the database inside. So a car is outside blocking, but I didn't catch the name. 118 at the end. So basically, you can do, you can, without a root, without the system permission, you can get all the information from the app. So you can backup the Facebook, you can backup the WhatsApp and everything which is there, which is kind of crazy at the end. And another way is to just change the bootloader. So you can change the bootloader, and having a change bootloader, it allows you to do a lot of crazy stuff if you use the correct bootloader. So search on XDA, and you can do a copy of the partition without any problem. So the phone is blocked. You don't have a pattern. You don't have the password. You flash a custom ROM. You get access to the phone. You copy the partition using the DD and so on. And at the end, you use a tool like this one, a desktop tool just to analyze the partition. So there are desktop tools to analyze just the raw partitions. But the problem is to get to that information. Now, this is the case where you have just only the phone and the phone is blocked and so on. So how we can snoop inside of such an application we can get out, you probably already know this, but let me help you a little bit. It's just like an APK tool, parameter D and the APK, and then you already have access to all the resources. Then you do a dext to jar from the classes you just extracted from the APK, and you can you obtain a jar file, which can use it with the decompiler. My favorite one is JDegui. And you use this just to see the whole code. Now, from my experience, like almost 90% of the application, they are not protected. 1% are obfuscated. So like 0.00 something, is they are in somehow protected. And there are tools for that, but they are somehow ignored by a lot of people. So you can basically use, for example, Dext2Guard, which is created by the guy who did the ProGuard product, and it's a Belgian product, costs like €750, and can help you to encrypt parts of, encrypt classes in your APK. So you can choose some of the classes which are in APK to encrypt them. So let's see what solution you have in case you are afraid somebody will get this information from your devices. So basically, you can destroy it. So like, not in the water will not help. I mean, like really take a hammer and smash it. You can override data on your device just as you do it in Windows, if you do this in Windows, or just hide the information if you want to hide it. Now, think about the platform is not hiding any information, really. There is no like platform support for the database which are there, for database in the context, for SMS and so on. Everything is just in a simple SQLite database. And there are some suggestions here. And this is also a suggestion for you as developers if you want to protect parts of your application. This is what we are doing, basically. This is a process which was at some point approved by the 2FIT, so the German certification company. So we have some application protected like this, and they pass a certain certification from 2FIT. And we were at that point the only company who had a certified Android application approved by 2FiT. So if you want to know more, I give you here 4 books. Take a look on them. There are also some, like, a lot of topics, maybe they are not actual anymore and so on, but take a look on them. They are extremely good information. And at the end, there are some tools here. So take a look at Undrealer. It's a really cool project where you can really get a lot of information out of devices, out of the box. The source code is available. Now, questions.